The Mutlang Evolving Drum Trick. It may be the opposite of how you've always done drums. Next on Music Surgery with me, Dr. Bob. Hey, you guys, quickly before we get started, please hit the subscribe button and ring the bell. And don't forget to check out the Doctor's Lounge, my store, and the links to some great samples below in the description of this video. So, some of what I'm about to show you is probably the opposite of everything you've ever done or thought about doing drums. But let's navigate our way through a song with peaks and valleys using Mutlang's mentality, and you'll see why it makes perfect sense. Watch this. All right, you guys, really great stuff this week. In many ways, and some of these things might be the opposite of what you've ever done, but it totally makes sense and is going to make a big difference in your tracks. So let me play you the intro into the verse of this, play a little bit of the verse, and we'll talk about it. Here we go. Okay, so here in the intro and the verse, my drums here are the biggest part of the song. Usually you would think, biggest drums in the chorus, that's the biggest part of the song. But let me show you what's going on here and why. So if you listen to it, you just basically hear a kick in the snare and, you know, hi-hats or whatever doing their thing. But let me take this verb sample out. So you can hear the ah of that sample is gone. Now let me put it in. Also, I have a kick drum that has more verb on it. So if I play these kick drums, you can hear the difference when that kick drum sample goes out. Here it is with. Without. So, in this first verse, I've got all of this. I've got this verb. I've also, on the first hit of the snare coming in, I've cranked this verb to show some, an announcement. Here comes the snare. Right there, I'll turn that up. So you can hear that. I mean, obviously, I exaggerated that for that. So when it comes down here to the chorus, you'll see that I've taken both the kick drum reverb and the snare reverb samples off, or I've automated those down for the chorus. There is the reverb for the snare. I'd probably even automate that down more. And for the kick. So why have I automated down those things that make the drums so big? Well, one reason is because the chorus is the biggest part of the song, arguably. The chorus, the last chorus. So in the chorus, everything's in, everything's big. Well, if everything's big, usually that means everything's small. So when I have all of these instruments coming in, there's a choir of Ebo, there's keys, there's other keys. These are just the things beside that come in additionally to what come in the verse. What else? And obviously I have these in as well. So what happens is all of those things take up frequency, and all of those things need attention. You need to pay attention as a listener in those things, to those things, because those are what grow a chorus. Besides background vocals and things like that, those instruments make the chorus bigger that are not in the verse. So what I have to do is I have to carve things away to make those things bigger, to make the chorus sound bigger. With all of these things in a chorus, all that type of reverb is going to do is make things cloudy. I've already established to the listener's ear that this reverb is part of the snare sound. So, psychoacoustically, they may most likely hear that snare as that sound the rest of the song, because I've introduced it that way. But what I can do, when the chorus comes in, I can reduce those type of reverb sounds to make room for the things that they will additionally pay attention to in the chorus that makes the chorus bigger, while always thinking that the snare has never changed. I love how big that snare is, but I've got to make room for that snare. Now, let's go down here to the bridge. Now, when we hear halftime, full time would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. A halftime beat is 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. The snare is hitting on 3. So what that tells me is I have a lot more room in the bar to introduce that reverb back in. So in the bridge here, I've introduced the kick drum reverb and the snare drum reverb back in to also make this section sound different than the chorus, but I've got more room to add things because there's more space. So, you hear that behind the snare, which fills up the larger cavernous space that's created by the way the groove is played. The groove isn't 1, 2, 3, 4. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So I've got more room to introduce those things. Also, to add to that, I've added these claps, which enhance the snare. So we're carving out different sections of the song to give you a different feeling. And halftime is a great way to introduce bigger verbs back into the song. So now what we have is, once we've introduced this, we have another problem. When those go away, the snare feels a little bit smaller. So what I've had to do is introduce those here when the snare goes back to full time, 1, 2, 3, 4, to keep the bigness and that sonic quality to the snare there. And after that, I've got a really nice break to where there's enough room before the rest of the song starts that I don't have to keep those in and have that space clouded on the last chorus. All that to say, let me show you what I mean. So I'll start halfway through the verse. You'll see that these clap hits start to hit on 2 and 4 when the drums do. But I've automated those down 3 dB just to keep the sonic of that clap in, but it's much further down to give way to the guitar solo. Here, watch this. So they're barely in there to keep that sizzly, snappy, clappy thing in with the snare, but not so loud. Let me take them out. Barely there, but you want to continue with the energy of those just a little bit, and then I have a nice break here where the listener's going to forget about that. So when I introduce the drums back in for the last chorus of the song, they've forgotten about this sonic. They know the drums sound big. They've been big the whole song. And what I've done in the end chorus, or what I'll do in the end chorus, is I'll bring this verb sample back down again to make room for things. And the kick drum is already down there. Actually, I can bring it up there because we're to halftime. And with the snare verb down at the end, we have room for all the guitars and the synth stuff. Not maybe what we're used to. We're used to making the drums bigger in the chorus because we want the chorus to be the biggest of all. But in essence, all those drum verbs and those spacious things, room mics, things like that that add ambience to the room in a chorus, you're just going to be killing everything else with those. I know this doesn't make sense, but there's ways to trick people's ears to think that the drums are still big, but your drums can't be big with all that other stuff coming in. So just take this into account that if your drums are smaller in the chorus, I'm not saying make them tiny. I'm saying take things away from the drums that are eating up space from the additional things that come in to really make the chorus seem bigger. Well, there you go. Sometimes old ways of thinking are hard to break, and less is really more. Try to use this headspace to make the sections in your song speak in different ways to get the biggest emotional impact. Thanks as always for watching. Give me some comment, love, and a thumbs up below, and hit me at drbobmusicsurgery@gmail.com if you want to say hello or you want me to work on your music. Take care of yourselves and each other, and I'll see you the next time the doctor's in.